Reverend William J. Barber has long tackled the issues of race, poverty, and hatred. Next month, his Poor People's Campaign will hold a digital assembly and march on Washington to draw attention to those and other civil rights issues. I recently spoke with Reverend Barber about the impacts of COVID-19 on communities of color for our ongoing initiative, Chasing the Dream, Poverty and Opportunity in America. Here's a short excerpt of our longer conversation, which will appear online at Chasing the Dream. Reverend William Barber, thanks so much for joining us. When you see those statistics about how disproportionately affected people of color are in this, why do you think that the country is not as shocked as they ought be?
Well, first of all, we're not getting all the statistics. I mean, we get, like in Mississippi, 80% of the people in one area that died from COVID-19. We're not as shocked because we weren't dealing with it before. See, we weren't shocked when 250,000 people were dying from poverty and low income. You know, we weren't shocked enough when the Supreme Court rolled back the Voting Rights Act. And since 2013, we've had less voting rights than we had since 1965. And McConnell, for instance, has blocked fixing the Voting Rights Act for over 2,000 days. We weren't really shocked as a nation when we knew before COVID, 62 million people got up and worked every day without a living wage. 4 million people could get up every morning and buy unleaded gas and not buy unleaded water. We were spending 53 cents of every discretionary dollar on the military and less than 15 cents of every discretionary dollar on education, infrastructure, and healthcare. Our consciousness has and moral consciousness has been so dulled, right? And we've been locked in this Reaganism, locked in this trickle-down, locked in this neoliberalism, and we've been locked in this left-right debate. The reality of poverty and low income is not about left and right. It's about the very soul and the heart of this nation, and that we are not upholding even our constitutional morality. I'm a preacher, but beyond the preaching part, establishment of justice, providing for the common defense, promoting the general welfare, ensuring domestic tranquility, equal protection under the law. When you look at these glaring statistics, even before COVID, we weren't shocked. So after COVID, some people still think it's over there. I'm concerned even, and I say this as an African-American, that we are not getting the data on poverty. We're not getting the data on zip code. I believe when we get the full data, we're gonna see, yes, it's killing African-Americans at enormous levels, but it's also killing poor white folk in Appalachia at enormous levels. And they don't have what they need. That's why we have been pulling together this Poor People's Campaign, a national call for a moral revival for 3 years, because we recognized years ago America needed a moral revival, a moral revolution of values, if you will, a conscious awakening, a shaking, you know, a restarting of the very heart of our nation, because we are in trouble when it comes to our consciousness. It is far too dull and we are accepting far too much.
How concerned are you about voter suppression, especially now, given the health concerns that people have with going to crowded places like polling stations?
I am concerned about voter suppression. I come from a voter suppression state. I know what can happen when state legislators and governors implement voter suppression law. We are so one of the things we're saying is register people to vote. We're saying to the Congress and particularly Democrats, we need that $2 billion that they need in the budget to protect our democracy. We're not going to probably get mail-in ballots. So we're saying to Democrats and other progressives, and even Republicans if they want the black vote or the white or the poor vote, but to the progressives, you better pass some legislation, even if McConnell strikes it down, that let folk know you're willing to fight for their lives, for the poor and low, because in the fall, you're going to ask them to risk their lives to vote. Literally, people will have to risk their lives, stand in lines to vote in the midst of this pandemic. Why did people in Selma risk their lives in 1965? Because they thought what they were risking their life for was worth it. We must give people the kind of policy agenda. If you vote for us, you're going to have health care that's not just connected to your job, but connected to your humanity. If you vote for us, you're going to have living wages. If you vote for us, you're going to have sick leave and adequate unemployment. If you vote for us, you're going to have access to clean water. If you vote for us, we're not going to cut your utilities off in the middle of a pandemic. We're going to have to give people a life what I call a moral budget, a moral agenda that says we care more about life than we do about profits. And then people, I believe, will mobilize in mass numbers to vote.
Reverend William Barber, thanks so much for joining us. I hope the next conversation we have is in a time when we can do it face to face. Thank you.
Thank you so much. God bless you. Love to all of you.